How's everybody doing? This is fantastic to see you all. I wanted to welcome you out to tonight's event. My name's Kai, and I'm in the new Master of Climate Change program at the University of Waterloo, something which I'm proud of UW for pioneering here in Canada. I'm also part of the Our Horizon UW Club on campus that is advocating for the bold initiative Mr. Shirkey is here to discuss, climate change warning labels on gas pump nozzles. We're proud to be hosting tonight's event. Can a simple sticker help us act on climate change? At the prestigious International Governance Innovation Center for International Governance Innovation, or CIGI, here in Waterloo. And want to thank the event coordinators, Lauren Amundsen and her team, for helping us to set up and providing this great space for our discussion. We're really happy to be here, so thank you. Please, a round of applause for them. I'd also like to thank everyone for coming out. I know we all have busy lives, and I hear there's even a pretty important hockey game going on tonight between Montreal and Boston competing with our event. So thank you to everyone for taking the time and making the choice to privilege today's talk on climate change over hockey. I won't say it was necessarily the right choice, but we are going to work hard to make this equally exciting and worth your time. As the climate change labeling initiative is ultimately a municipal initiative, which Mr. Shirkey will speak to, I'd like to especially thank our city staff, councillors, and any mayors from the region out there who have made time in their busy schedules to come hear about this and what it can offer towards improving our shared communities. It is thanks to the leadership of people such as you that the Waterloo region is such a vibrant, innovative place to live, and we're here to help make it even better. So, a round of applause to you as well. Thanks. And I'd like to thank the two people on stage with us tonight, guiding this discussion. Mr. Shirkey on the left, or Rob as I've come to know him. For myself, a good friend and former employer who has championed the idea of climate change warning labels for well over a year now through the Canadian nonprofit Our Horizon, mostly on his own dollar, out of deep concern for the issue of climate change. He also has a busy schedule, and we're lucky to have him in Waterloo tonight, as it's certainly not every night we get to hear about a game-changing initiative like this. So let's give him a round of applause. Now, we know Rob's always needed a moderator. So the last gentleman on the stage is Eric Rumble, editor-in-chief at Alternatives Journal, or AJ, a much-loved and respected Canadian environmental journal located right here in our community. AJ was the first publication to welcome Our Horizon into this community and has since continued to offer its support, and Eric in particular is well-qualified to be leading the discussion to follow Rob's talk. A true local to the region of Waterloo, with a Bachelor of History from UW, he's since worked as a journalist in Canada for more than a decade, with editing positions for publications such as Up Magazine, Adbusters, Reader's Digest, and now Waterloo's own Alternatives Journal. Eric is also the creative director of Night Shift, Downtown Kitchener's nocturnal community building festival, and the second annual version of which will take place on Saturday, November 1st, and he'll be leading the question period in the second half of tonight's event. Lastly, I'd like to thank our local support through the Our Horizon UW Club, some of whom you'll see in the white Our Horizon t-shirts here, and others who pass on their regrets but are here in spirit tonight. This crew has put in a lot of behind-the-scenes work into making tonight possible and bringing you all here today, and would love to chat with you after the event about why this matters to them and to the region. Our Horizon is really only as strong as its local support, spread now coast to coast and around the world. And we owe a great deal to those volunteers who believe in this cause as we do and wish to see meaningful action taken on climate change, not just internationally, but also here at home. If at the end of this evening you're interested in staying in touch and getting involved, please see us in the foyer to pass on some contact info, and we'll let you know how you can help make this all happen. So without further ado, I'd like to pass the floor over to Eric to really introduce our main speaker and get this night started. We hope by the end of this night you'll feel as inspired and excited as we do about the need to not just continue to talk about climate change, but to actually get up and act on it. We've already seen strong leadership within this community in this direction through the Waterloo Region Climate Action Plan and other great initiatives, and would like to move the yardstick even further. As a final note, I'd ask that you please turn off your cell phones or any digital devices if you have them as we are recording this event. And thank you.
I'm going to stand up because I feel funny sitting down and talking. But to start, just by a show of hands, how many people got gas at a gas pump in the last week or so? So you don't have to show your hands, but what do you remember about being in that space? The reason I ask that question is what I really like about this idea, what struck me the first time I saw it is just I love the idea of turning this meaningless space that you don't really remember what you were doing there, you're thinking something else, or maybe you're angry about the price that you're paying for gas or whatever it is, and turning it into an opportunity for really critical reflection, and maybe becoming equally frustrated with other numbers like 400 parts per million, something like that. So I'm really excited. I've got a sneak preview of the talk that Rob's going to give tonight, which will be somewhere around 45 minutes,
hopefully.
Yeah. But I'll try and keep him in check there as much as I can. And what'll happen is once he's done his talk, I'm gonna ask him a few questions to get the ball rolling. But we would love it if anybody wants to come and ask questions as well. There's microphones at either side of the room. Just come down to the microphone, and I'll keep my eyes peeled for anybody that comes down, and I'll turn it over to anybody that wants to ask a question once we're into the Q&A segment. Okay, I'm going to sit down now. So Rob.
Eric.
Rob is a graduated with distinction from Laurier, Wilfrid Laurier University in business and economics not that long ago. He told me a great story about his valedictorian speech, actually, this on the bus down here, which maybe we'll get time to get into. But he after graduating there, he studied law at UVic and came back to Ontario after that, started working for an environmental NGO. He practiced law in North Bay and then was working in his own practice in Toronto as well before last... Sorry, I have to check my notes again. Early 2013.
Yep.
You decided to give up it all and give it all up and launch Our Horizon. Our Horizon, just a real brief snippet of history, but Rob will delve more deeply into it, is, last year the Our Horizon raised through crowdfunding $15,000 in order to do a cross-country tour. The money came from places all over the world, and that tour and the build-up to it has drawn support from a number of different prominent environmental organizations across the country, David Suzuki Foundation, Canadian Physicians for the Environment, to name a couple. And what's really exciting is the momentum that it's building now, and I'm gonna let Rob, reveal the surprise a little bit later. But there is movement, and there's a particular municipality in Canada that just in the last few days has sort of made a move to start actually bringing this concept into reality. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Rob and let him talk to us about how a simple sticker can maybe help us act on climate change. So please give Rob a round of applause.
Thank you. Thanks, Eric. Thank you. It's a solid handshake, by the way. We've had this discussion before. Everyone ensure when you leave, before you leave, shake his hand. He'll have a clinic at the end of this. Can a simple sticker help us act on climate change? Yes. I'm a little biased, but no, that's not the end. Can a simple sticker help us act on climate change? I think the answer is yes. Hopefully I'll share some of my rationale and convince you to believe that, yeah, indeed, that is the case. A simple little sticker can help us act on climate change. I remember it was the summer of 2010. That was actually the summer that the in the Gulf of Mexico, the deep water horizon, the offshore rig exploded. Do you guys remember that? And for 2 months that summer, it was just leaking oil out every day for 2 months. And I remember being on the highway, on the 401, just leaving to Toronto to come to Waterloo, actually, to visit some friends, who I see in the audience right now, hi. And there I was, stuck in traffic. There's this one segment just in really near Yonge, I guess, just west of Yonge, I think, where there's actually 14 lanes, so seven lanes, and I had the radio on, and I heard pundits and callers and every single person blame British Petroleum, BP, for this. And as I sat in traffic, and it was stopped both ways, thousands of cars within eyesight, idling, burning fossil fuel derived from our Earth, and I thought to myself at that time, there would be millions of cars stuck in traffic as well. I recognized I had this moment where, you know what, I felt complicit, and I thought we all share in responsibility when it comes to climate change, when it comes to these sorts of tragedies, and we tend to focus upstream, I think partly because it's a little more comfortable to do that. It's a little more comfortable to blame the tar sands, pipelines, shipping, offshore drilling, and so on. But if it weren't for us, if it weren't for the demand side of the equation, none of these things would really exist. So it's important that we reflect on that and think of that part of the equation. And I'm using that story as an intro because that's actually where our name comes from. I remember thinking about that, and when I was thinking of a name for this organization, I thought, I don't want that to be on our horizon. I want to create a different horizon, our horizon. So this name, I guess, it's an invitation to build something together, a much better, brighter future. A lot of you probably actually show of hands, who here accepts climate science, we'll say? Awesome. Any deniers? Oh, I thought I saw a hand. No, ish. No, you're playing with your hair. Okay, cool. Just to make sure we're on the same page, super, super quick background on climate science. So scientists have taken ice core samples. The record goes as far back as 800,000 years. And if you're to look at the range, the whole entire range, basically what scientists do is they take trapped tiny bubbles of air, ancient atmosphere. They look at it, they analyze to determine the CO2, the carbon dioxide content in that. And the historic range, really for all intents and purposes, human history, is 180 to 300 parts per million. If you take a random sample of air, even a fistful of air in this room, and if you're to look at the carbon dioxide concentration in that, you get 400 parts per million. And all of you, I'm sure, have seen this Al Gore's film where there's this curve that goes like that, right? It's exponential CO2 growth. So a lot of that is just in recent history. So where we are today, for all intents and purposes, is unprecedented. What I find interesting was this study published by an organization called the Carbon Tracker Initiative out of the UK. And I'll get into that in a second. But this 2 degrees figure has significance. So in 2009, the world got together in Copenhagen. It was a conference of the parties of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. And one of the things that came out of that conference was this objective, this political consensus, that we can't raise the Earth's temperature since the Industrial Revolution by more than 2 degrees Celsius. And that is our current political consensus. Canada we're supposed to abide by that figure too, countries all over the world. And what that figure does in effect is it creates a ceiling. So if you work back from that, if you understand that as we burn fossil fuels, we emit greenhouse gases, that creates warming, we can only burn so much before we reach that 2 degrees centigrade Celsius figure. So what scientists did is they asked the question, well, how much fossil fuel can we burn, how much CO2 can we emit before we commit to that 2 degrees figure? The answer they came up with is 565 gigatons worth of carbon dioxide. And I've seen figures slightly lower, slightly higher, but the concept remains the same, and that seems to be the general consensus. When you set a cap on temperature increase, you realize that you can only burn so much fossil fuel. And to put that figure into perspective, this data is a little bit old. I'd love to hear newer data. Some of you, I'm sure, have it. But in 2011, globally, we emitted 31.6 gigatons worth of carbon dioxide, and that's a 3% increase over the year before. So if you put 31.6 into 565 with that 3% rate of growth, you actually get something like 15 or 16 years left at status quo emissions until we commit to that figure. So we really have a short timeline to act on this issue. What I'm going to show next, this next figure, I find is most interesting. And so my background, of course, at Laurier was in business economics. And so this group out of the United Kingdom, a group of financial analysts got together and they asked the question, okay, so that's how much we can burn to get to that figure, but how much is there left to burn? And to figure out sort of an approximate figure for that, what they did is they opened up annual reports of companies that trade in fossil fuels. So they looked at Shell's annual report, they looked at Exxon's annual report, and so on, and they looked at their assets. In their assets, they list their proven reserves. So that's the amount of coal, oil, and natural gas that they've identified as being under the earth and that they intend on extracting and bringing to market for us to burn. And so they added them all up to get this figure, 2,795 gigatons worth of carbon dioxide. And you'll notice that's roughly five times the amount that brings us to 2 degrees Celsius. And so that is the amount. That's kind of the business plan. That's the game plan today. We intend on doing that. And if we do, we're going to look at a temperature increase, something in the range of 5 to 6 degrees Celsius. It was actually the chief economist of the IEA, the International Energy Agency, which is a fairly conservative organization, that said that that figure is more in line with that temperature increase. And he said our window to this 2 degree trajectory is fast closing, so we really do need to act. In the few years since that study came out, the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, which is the global authority on climate science, has endorsed these findings. And not that long ago, it was the head of the IPCC that said, and this is near verbatim, we need to leave the vast majority of fossil fuels underground. The World Bank, the IMF, are also saying we need to transition away from fossil fuels, and this is more and more the consensus. This is now the reality that we face. So, given that this is the position, the point in time where we find ourselves, we have to ask the question, okay, so what are some of the ways that we can help transition away from fossil fuels and embrace renewables, use fossil fuels conservatively? And I'm here to propose a simple tool that I think is quite powerful and has the potential to make quite an impact. And one of the things that I'd ask you just to remember as I go through a variety of slides is this basic idea. The first step in addressing any problem is to honestly face it. Even if you reflect on challenges in your own life, whatever it may be, the first step is honestly facing that problem. The more you sort of look away from it, the more you deny it, the longer you delay, the worse it tends to get. And so what I propose to do is that, face climate change, face the reality of what we're up against. That's our hashtag, face the change. If anyone has a Twitter account, feel free to tweet under that, by the way. And I propose that we name our problem. Let's figuratively and quite literally, actually, let's label this. Let's identify it so we can then move forward in meaningful ways. We've come up with a few mock-ups, and these are the labels that we have printed out. Some of you maybe saw these in the front when you came in. We're not necessarily married to this particular design, but we just had to come up with a label instead of advocating for this in the abstract. So these are some of the things we've come up with. This language here, 30% of species at a likely risk of extinction, that comes not from the most recent climate assessment report out of the IPCC, AR5 they're on now, but AR4, my understanding is that figure should actually be revised upward. So you can have something that speaks to extinction of species. Drought and famine, of course, something many of you know is a consequence of climate change. You can have something to show that. Ocean acidification, another effect of climate change that not that many people know about, surprisingly, but is quite frightening when you sort of look into it and realize that we've actually changed the pH level in our oceans. And then, of course, when it comes to emissions from vehicles, beyond climate change, there's local impact. So emissions from vehicles have been related to lung cancer, cardiovascular disease, respiratory disease, and so on. And this highlights what is actually quite local in nature. And you'll notice on the last couple of slides, we've had this bit here. To learn more, go to wecandobetter.me. And the idea is, much like on a package of cigarettes, they set it up problem, solution. So they say, use of this product can cause a harm, and then go to this website to learn how to quit. So we're proposing you could have something like that, where if you go to maybe that website /Kitchener/Waterloo/Cambridge/Guelph, there might be some local resources, local options, things you can do. But we're more interested in causing a greater shift, which I'll get into in some subsequent slides. So people often ask me, I'm sure some of you guys are thinking here, does anyone wonder, do those warning labels on tobacco packages actually work? Yes? Good. Okay, this slide is for you. Yeah, they do work. Next slide. No. So, the amazing thing is, in 2001, Canada became the first jurisdiction in the world to require visual warning labels on tobacco packages. How did we do that? We led. We said, let's do this, which I'm going to get into a little bit later. Ultimately, I think that's the way you need to change things. But we said, let's do this, and we did. It's since then, so roughly a decade later, a little more than a decade later, now more than 60 countries in the world have adopted this. And it was in 2009 that the European Union commissioned a meta-study, so a study of studies, to look at the effectiveness of these warning labels. In that study, they included over 200 independent studies from countries all over the world, all that sought to answer the question, are these labels effective? The short of it is, and it's Sandbrook International, if any of you care to look it up, but the short of it is, they work. They help to change both attitudes and behavior. So the studies are certainly there, but I asked myself as a lawyer, you know, would tobacco companies spend millions of dollars hiring lawyers to fight this legislation wherever it pops up in the world? If it didn't work, that would be a poor business decision to make. Why spend all that money if it didn't affect your bottom line? But more generally, there is an entire consumer packaged goods industry that spends a lot of money on tinkering with packaging, and they'll hire psychologists, they'll run focus groups, and they'll test different colors and copy and fonts and designs and pictures, all with the explicit purpose of influencing consumer attitudes and behavior. So of course the way you package, the way you present a product has that effect. But I'm going to suggest to you that in the context of climate change, our labels are actually even more compelling. And I'll tell you why. There's three reasons. So first of all, climate change can be understood as a problem of no feedback. So there's a delay between cause and effect. We burn fossil fuels today, the consequences of which aren't experienced until tomorrow. Unlike, for example, let's say I were to put my hand on a hot stove. I would get this change in my environment, this hot stove, and this instant pain signal. It's this a feedback that forces me then, I take off my hand from that hot stove. It's an adaptive quality that lets me survive and thrive. In the absence of feedback, in the absence of that signal, we fall prey to our cognitive biases. So psychologists know, they call it the current moment bias or hyperbolic discounting. They know that we tend to prefer interests that are near and small relative to those that are significant, but down the road. So who here, I know there are some students here, who here, instead of studying for that big important test next week, opted to watch that half-hour episode of The Simpsons? Right? We've all been there. There's some honest people in the back. Thank you. It's human nature. We procrastinate. And what this does, this simple little tool, it creates feedback. It brings those faraway consequences, be it extinction of species, drought and famine, ocean acidification, extreme weather, brings it into the here and now to help counteract the current moment bias, to build feedback to help us then move forward, not in maladaptive ways, but in adaptive ways. So it takes a problem of no feedback, it builds feedback. Two, climate change can be understood as a problem of diffusion of responsibility. So I emit a little bit, Kai emits a little bit, Eric emits a little bit. As individuals, our contribution to the problem is small, but collectively, our actions are altering the chemistry of the planet. Social psychologists know, and they see this play out in all sorts of scenarios, social psychologists know that when responsibility for something is diffuse, so when it's shared among many, we're less likely to act. And the fix is actually quite intuitive. So show of hands, who here has ever taken a CPR course? Okay, good. So I'm going to put you on the spot. I'm going to test you guys. If, God forbid, if I had to give CPR to Eric, this is my...
That's your CPR.
That's my CPR. I need to take a class, evidently. It's probably not proper CPR. Would I say, somebody, anybody, please call 911, or would I say, you ma'am, call 911 and get back to me? Which is it? It's the latter, right? And the reason for that, of course, is when responsibility for intervention is shared among many, there's actually less likelihood that we act. And so what this idea does, the placement of the warning label on the gas pump nozzle takes a problem of diffuse origins and quite literally locates responsibility right in the palm of your hand. Now, I recognize I'm going to speak to you guys for an hour about a sticker, but it's actually quite revolutionary when you think about it, because there's nothing like it out there. You can read books on climate change, you could see documentaries, read reports, read it in the news, but all of those have the problem as being out there. This connects you to the problem of climate change in quite a direct way, and I think it will have a significant impact. So it takes a problem of diffuse origins and it locates responsibility. Last, climate change can be understood as a problem of negative externalities, and this is a concept from economics that I find is best illustrated by use of an example. So let's say a liter of gasoline costs $1.35 at the pump. In that price are a variety of costs that the producer had to incur in order to bring that product for us, the consumer, to consume. So there was some labor that had to be paid for that went into extracting the oil out of the earth. There were some machines, some energy that went into that process. The oil had to be shipped somewhere. It had to be refined. The costs go higher and higher. It had to be transported to an individual retailer. Of course, there's a profit margin, there's a markup, and there's taxes on top of that. All of that goes to inform that price of $1.35, and that's the signal to the marketplace of the cost of the product. But economists know that during this, a lot of costs have been externalized. So, for example, if we burn fossil fuels, we contribute to climate change. That causes melting, causes a rise in sea level, necessitates then the spending of billions of dollars for us to adapt our coastal infrastructure to the effects of climate change. That is a cost that can and should be reflected in the price of the product that's actually causing the harm. Economists say we should internalize these costs. So you might see some upgrades to coastal infrastructure as an external cost. Maybe there's some health impacts. Maybe there's a loss in crops, so agriculture takes a hit. There's extreme weather, so on and so on. The costs go higher and higher. Through something like a carbon tax or a cap and trade regime, we can internalize those costs, signal the true cost of the product to the marketplace, and that's how you then facilitate a market shift. The trouble, of course, is, you know, it's one thing to price the concrete and rebar that goes into upgrading our coastal infrastructure, but how on earth do you price a species that might face extinction? What is the value of human suffering? What is the value of a human life? And while economists actually price those things, we actually price life to make decisions, we ask, as an organization, and me personally too, I ask, have we sort of got the point where we know the price of everything and the value of nothing? Is there another way to capture and communicate these externalities to the marketplace? The answer, of course, is yes, there is. So what price seeks to capture in this quantitative way through the use of dollars and cents, our idea captures in a qualitative way through the use of image and text. So notice in the abstract, they're actually both doing the same thing. They're capturing and communicating externalities to the marketplace, but our idea nurtures a focus that I think is different from that other approach, complementary to that other approach, but I think it has the potential to take us from complaining about the price of gas, but maybe not doing anything about it, to engaging our sense of humanity, to actually then acting on this issue. It takes a problem of externalities and it communicates them. And I'd like to explore some of this economic theory a little bit further. So there's this idea out there on the left that we'll call the dominant economic paradigm, and it's this idea you've all heard, we as human beings are selfish, we're self-interested, wealth-maximizing beings that respond like automatons to price signals, right? We've heard this before. So that's one worldview. There's another worldview, maybe a complementary worldview, maybe a separate one, but this idea that we're different from that. We're more than that. We're moral, empathetic beings that care for the welfare of others. And while I didn't bring, I forgot, I actually just moved recently, and I have at the bottom of a box Adam Smith's theory of moral sentiments. But Adam Smith himself, actually, who we often associate what's on the left, has written a lot about what's on the right. And I encourage you, maybe Kai, you can pull this up on your laptop during the Q&A, but read the first page of the first chapter of Adam Smith's Theory of Moral Sentiments, and it'll blow your mind what he's talking about. He's talking about all that stuff on the right, which is fascinating. But, sorry, tangent, and you've got to keep me on time. So if your worldview is the thing on the left, you naturally then build up from that to advocate for something like a price signal, because that's what we are, that's what we respond to. That's sort of the language that would speak to us. If your worldview is something like that, if that's your foundation, you then build up from that, maybe to advocate for a policy something like ours. And notice again, so in the abstract, they both achieve the same thing, but price tends to answer the question, how does this affect my wallet? How does this affect me? Our idea tends to answer the question, how does it affect others? So it highlights interconnectedness, which I actually think is at the core of a lot of the reason we move forward in unsustainable ways. And there's an organization that's called MeToWe, and I like to say, this is maybe an interesting way where you could promote a cultural shift that gets from MeToWe, right? Oh crap, I'm running out of time. That's the MeToWe plug. I'm not getting paid. Actually, I don't get paid at all. Okay, back on track. So the interesting thing, of course, is while worldview can inform choice of policy, I think policy can reinforce worldview. So the more of that narrative, the more those sort of signals, those market signals we have on the left, I think it reinforces that idea. If we were to have a market signal, and it is a market signal, if you look closely at it, it's not actually prescribing anything. It's just providing the marketplace with relevant information and letting the marketplace respond. And if we have that sort of a thing, I think it can help maybe even create a different narrative. But less theory, something practical. Who has here heard of these studies that came out of Israel daycares? Anyone? Oh, good, a few of you. Okay. So what's interesting is parents were coming late to pick up their kids at these daycares, and a bunch of economists said, well, you know what? There's an externality there. For every minute, half hour, hour, someone comes late, the cost, of course, is to this person's schedule. They may have had dinner plans, they may have wanted to do a social engagement, see a movie and so on, they have to cancel that. So there's that external cost that can be attributed to the parent coming late. So let's price that. For every minute a parent is late, they now owe the daycare $1. You're late 15 minutes, $15 and so on. So who here thinks people started to come a little bit more on time? Show of hands. Who here thinks people started to come roughly around the same time, it had no effect? And who here thinks people actually came later? Okay, you guys win. It's always C. People came later. And what happened is lateness was commodified by pricing it. It became something for the parents and the daycare provider to exchange, to buy and sell. And behavioral economists observe that when pricing externalities, sometimes you actually shut off that moral cue that would otherwise regulate behavior. So I think this idea is an important complement to pricing mechanisms, and I do think we need some way of pricing these harms, but it's an important complement to that. It can also be a window to that, because a lot of our discourse in Canada right now, if you even say the word carbon tax, there's a huge segment of society that says you're out to destroy the economy and kill Canadian families. I'm not kidding you, an MP actually said those words, which is ridiculous. Anyway, so I think this is something that could maybe help shift the conversation where something like what's on the left might be a little bit more palatable. But let's get back to the practical. So gasoline, really simple, it's just energy stored in hydrocarbons. The internal combustion engine, all that does is it takes that energy, that chemical energy, converts it into mechanical, useful energy. And you actually see two things that come as a result of that. So believe it or not, the vast majority of energy in gasoline is lost to heat and exhaust. Only about 20% of that is converted into useful mechanical energy to use to move the wheels forward. But of course, of that 20%, you're actually moving two things. So in 2010, the average new vehicle in North America weighed about 4,000 pounds. The average person might weigh something like 150 pounds. If you realize you're actually moving about 96% of the wait, and oftentimes the statistic, at least where I live in Toronto, during rush hour, it's 1.1 it's people per vehicle. So if you realize you're only moving that, of that 20% useful energy, if you realize only 4% of that goes to move you from A to B, and if you multiply that out, it's actually a little bit less than 1%. So of the useful energy in gasoline, only 1% goes to move you from A to B. The rest is basically all lost to heat and exhaust and moving a big heap of metal back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. If you take this idea further, you realize that 99 cents of every dollar is actually kind of wasted, and the vast majority of pollution is actually kind of pointless. Now imagine if we treated other natural resources in this way. Oil's just a natural resource, trees are natural resources. What if you only effectively used 1%? So let's say you walked into the woods, you harvested those trees, much like you might harvest oil. You then processed them, much like you process oil, so you took them to this timber mill. You then brought it to a retailer, where it was then sold. A person brought it home, say, to a construction site to actually then consume it. And if they use it in the same way as we use fossil fuels, they would only use 1%. And we would say that is incredibly wasteful, but that's a visible waste. This other waste is invisible. In 1908, the Ford Model T was the first vehicle to be produced, came off the mass assembly line, and it got between 6 and 9 kilometers per liter. That's actually off of Ford's website. In 1950, the Oldsmobile, almost half a century later, gets about the same amount, typical car, 9 kilometers. In 2012, Cadillac Escalade, I picked that because that's the ride of my mare, gets about 6 kilometers per liter. But if you get a more fuel-efficient vehicle, you're actually not looking at much better than that. So over the course of a century, when it comes to fuel economy, the industry is actually stagnated. Above the line is what makes it to market. Below the line is what never makes it to market. So every year, Shell hosts something called the Eco Marathon in Europe, in the Americas, in Asia. And they invite high school students and university students to design the most fuel-efficient vehicle they can. The world's record, 2006, the most fuel-efficient vehicle got over 5,000 kilometers per liter. Mind you, that ran on a hydrogen fuel cell, so they did an equivalent calculation. But this is a typical car. This one didn't even take the top prize. Runs on regular old gasoline. The only reason I chose it is because it reminds me of the Oscar Mayer hot dog Wienermobile. But it was built in 2012 by high school students. It got 930 kilometers per liter. In 2013, the winner of the gasoline prototype vehicle, so a car that runs on regular gasoline, got just under 3,000 kilometers per liter on its best run. So, of course, these vehicles are at the extreme end of efficiency. They're very light, they're low to the ground, so they're aerodynamic, and they only go maybe 30, 40 kilometers per hour. But the point is, we're actually capable of doing a lot better. We just need to be challenged to do better. We need a bit of an impetus, we need a bit of a nudge, and I like to think that, we all know the expression, necessity is the mother of invention. I like to think this might inject a little more necessity, shake us out of our sense of complacency, and actually challenge us to do better. So, what do I foresee happening at the pump? As Eric mentioned, people don't even think about it. It's going to the gas station is regular. We've never thought about it. I actually ran a little experiment on my mom. Poor mom, I experiment on her all the time. Sorry, mom, she's probably gonna see this on the web one day. But basically, I looked at her gauge. I looked at the needle in her car, see if it was getting close to low. And there was one morning when it was close to low, and then later in the evening, I went and looked again, and it was full. And so I asked my mom, hey, how was your day? And she told me about her day. Where all did you go today? Tell me every single place you went to today. Well, I went to work, and then I got groceries, and then I came home. Is that every single place you went to today? Think about your day hard. Yeah, I went to work, I got groceries, and then I came home. By chance, did you stop at a gas station? Oh, yeah, I stopped at a gas station, right? We don't think about it. We never draw attention to this thing. We talk about climate change, tar sands, pipelines, and so on, but we've never stopped to examine this simple act, this act that has been normal for my whole entire life, for my parents' whole entire lives, just a couple of generations. What this idea does is it draws attention to it. So it disrupts the status quo. All of a sudden, this is then challenged. And someone might be at the pump and say, well, okay, if not this, then what? And just by forcing that question, just by disrupting the status quo, you create space for alternatives. So I foresee two things happening. One, it might lead to some individual behavioral change. If someone is concerned enough about climate change and they see this once a week, twice a week, however often they pump gas, they might start to think, you know what, maybe I might take more advantage of the bus, or maybe there's an LRT coming into my community soon that I want to take advantage of. Maybe I'll ride my bike in the summer when the weather's nice. So you might see some individual behavioral change, but what I'm more interested in is how this can cause a collective shift. So if an entire community is made to quite literally face the reality of climate change, I think that's a way to create then an honest discussion about what we want this place to look like in the future. It's a way then of giving a politician that forever has wanted to fund public transit, but can't, because politically it's sometimes tricky to suggest we pay for stuff, it might give them a little more political license, a little more political capital to actually pursue something like that, maybe build more bike lanes at other levels of government. Maybe we could even change the conversation around something like a carbon tax. You'll see government respond. I think you'll also see business respond. So in that moment, we've created the sense of dissatisfaction in the marketplace with the existing solution for your mobility needs. The flip side of that, of course, is we've stimulated now demand for alternatives. A business, you know, that builds cars, they're basically just in the business of selling you a mobility solution. If they see that this segment of the marketplace isn't being catered to, they're going to say, you know what? I want to capture a share of that market that we now care of this idea, help to create. So you'll see businesses invest research and development dollars into solutions that might even bring something like the price of an electric vehicle down. You'll see then through greater market interest, economies of scale, prices go down, options will be more affordable. So it's a way of facilitating this market shift. I think you'll also see, if automakers fail to respond, you'll see new market entrants come in and actually occupy that space. So you could think of it as a catalyst for change. And I want to highlight this again only because right now the discourse in Canada is largely focused on upstream. So we talk about tar sands, we talk about pipelines, offshore drilling, but we never ask the question, how do we use fossil fuels? And I would propose to you that the value of a commodity is largely based on its uses. So if it weren't for cars, planes, plastics, and so on, the substance would actually be this useless goo in the ground. We wouldn't have any of these things, so it's critical that we look at uses. And one thing too, just to highlight, so this analysis comes from the NRDC. It's a well-to-wheel analysis of greenhouse gas emissions, so it's the whole entire cycle from drawing it out of the ground to burning it in your car. Canadian oil sands, and we're going to compare that to Canada conventional crude, we've all heard tar sands are 3 to 4 times more carbon intensive than other sources of fuel. So that is at extraction, and yeah, it's maybe 3 to 4 times as carbon intensive. But look at the greenhouse gas emissions as a percentage of the overall cycle from well to wheel. You'll notice that the elephant in the room is us, vehicle operation. So even if tomorrow we shut down the tar sands and we said, let's just go to regular conventional oil, we still have a big problem. At the end of the day, we really need to focus on shifting consumer demand. How are we going to do this? We're asking municipalities to lead. We're asking communities to pass bylaws that require gasoline retailers to, as a condition of maintaining their license to do business in the community, put these warning labels on their gas pump nozzles. And we're engaging youth to do this, and there's an exciting announcement I'll make at the end of the talk. But this is Jonah. He's a 13-year-old kid from Toronto. He's signed up to do a deputation when we move this forward, where I'm from, in the city of Toronto. He's actually going to speak directly to his councillors. So even if you're not old enough to vote, no matter how old you are as a citizen of a community, you can actually go and speak directly to your councillors at a deputation. And it's important that our representatives hear from this demographic, because it's the decisions that we make today that will shape their future. And I see we're probably low on time. I've even forgot our single. We're at 40 minutes, okay. How about we'll get into some of the case law during the Q&A, because I recognize we're getting low on time. So do ask me about the tobacco warning label history. But we've been endorsed. This idea has been endorsed by a lot of organizations, the David Suzuki Foundation, Canadian Association of Physicians for the Environment, Clean Air Partnership, the Toronto chapters of 350.org, Transition Communities. We've been in all sorts of media. We were actually even interviewed in Germany. Deutsche Welle is Germany's equivalent to the CBC. We did a radio interview. They have millions of listeners. So this idea is really starting to spread. This is actually my favorite endorsement. Kai, you should actually stop Kai. He's got a good story. Kai went to Warsaw, Poland for COP19, the Conference of the Parties, with a suitcase full of gas pump nozzles, which presents some interesting security concerns. But do ask him. He's got a good story. But what's interesting is a delegate that's been to all 19 COP meetings every single year since this whole thing started came up to him and said, I've been to all 19 of these meetings, and I've never seen an idea so simple yet so powerful. One last slide to show you on psychology. So cognitive priming. When I came up with this idea, I thought, you know what? The warning labels on tobacco packages exist all over the world. There's an audience that's been primed to get this concept. And everything we've heard since has sort of validated that. So when we first came out with this, I got emails and tweets and Facebook posts from Brazil, from Australia, from all over the world, people saying, oh, that's exactly like what we do with our tobacco products. How can we do this over here? So there's an audience on the advocacy side that's been primed to get this idea. In fact, it was even just before I came here, this Facebook page that's based in Australia shared some of our content. So it's already starting to spread. The interesting thing is, though, also on cognitive priming, when this is passed into law, the theory suggests that all those same negative associations, emotions, that whole framework we apply to tobacco, we were very deliberate in how we designed the warning labels, might then be applied to fossil fuels. We might start to think about them in the same way and think about how that then can contribute to a shift. This is actually some web analytics from a website that was hosting some of our content. It was during the Cross Canada Tour that some of our content, we were really pushing it out, went viral. We've actually had people from all over the world see our stuff. And this was only a year ago, a little over a year ago, that we launched this. I'd like to end on this story. So it was 1991, the town of Hudson, Quebec. It was the first community in North America that actually passed a ban on the use of cosmetic pesticides. And it was these three counselors here that in my books are heroes, these three brave counselors in the face of significant threat to litigation from the chemical industry said, we're gonna pass this because we think this is the right thing to do. It passed. Now more than 80% of Canadians live in a jurisdiction with either a provincial law or a municipal law that can be traced back to the decision of these three people. The interesting thing is, Diane Sachs, who's a prominent environmental lawyer, one of the top environmental lawyers in Canada and renowned globally, just before we kicked off our cross-country tour, she wrote an article in Municipal World, which is a magazine that's read by city and town staff from coast to coast, that explored some of the legal foundations of our bylaw. And it's a short article, so I'd invite you to read my longer piece that's 40 pages, which I know is a lot, but if you're really interested, I would recommend it. And I'm happy to sign it. Please, someone asked me to do that, I'd feel cool. But she ended her article, where is the next Hudson? So what we need here is leadership. And this is some leadership right here. You'll notice the watermark has always been a maple leaf, but here the watermark is an American flag. It was around the time we were doing the cross-country tour that a group, a chapter of 350 from Bay Area, San Francisco, reached out to us and they said, whoa, this is really cool, and we've had this idea in the past, and we started to do a petition, but I like your research and this whole diffusion of responsibility and feedback thing. And so they contacted us, and every month we have a strategy session on Skype. I give them all of our research, all of our talking points, all of our strategy, and while I've been focused on raising awareness across Canada, they've poured all their efforts into the city of Berkeley, and I want you to read this. I'm actually getting emotional just reading this. To protect the environment and the health, safety, and welfare of its citizens, the City of Berkeley herein, by this chapter, intends to require warning labels on the sale of gasoline. I think that deserves a round of applause. Right? Pretty amazing leadership from our neighbors to the south. All establishments selling gasoline shall provide consumer information to all persons purchasing gasoline in Berkeley by placing labels on gas pumps. So this vote happened in March. It was unanimous. Council there decided, we want to do this. Right now, it's in the middle of being reviewed by staff. Early indications are staff is confident that this would withstand judicial scrutiny, and early indications are the councillors that all voted for it are going to vote for it in June. So it could be as early as June that Berkeley creates a global precedent. And they're looking at 2015 for implementation, which is really exciting. But I have another exciting story to show you. And I'm going to play you a clip from a video. This is something that just happened on the West Coast on Monday night.
Honorable council members, I want you to mandate that all gas pumps in our municipality must have warning labels on them, cautioning us against the harms that burning fossil fuels cause. My name is Emily Kelsall, and I'm another teenager who is scared for my future. Maybe our high school textbooks will look back on this and point to a small community that made an impact big enough to ripple and make changes in the course of history. In November 2013, a delegate at United Nations COP19 climate conference in Warsaw, Poland, upon seeing our gas nozzle said, "I've been to all 19 COP meetings, and I've never seen an idea so simple yet so powerful." West Vancouver is already a leader in so many ways, but if we employ this, we will not just become a leader, we will leave a legacy, an impact that will never be forgotten.
Emily, you're just an inspiration.
Oh, thanks.
Thank you. Thank you. And this is an interesting opportunity that's in front of us. So I think one of the things that I would like to see happen, because I know staff is working on a community energy plan, that your information and your proposal be embedded in that.
I think it's a great idea. A very small community, I think it was in Quebec, was the first community to ban pesticides. And the pesticide companies, through all kinds of litigation at that small municipality, they were able to overcome it. And now, you know, the majority of municipalities in Canada have pesticide bylaws,
right,
as we do. So it does take leadership from one community to get it going.
So reminded, out of the minds of youth come some great things. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a very sensible idea. This is an initiative that you, certainly when you get to be my age, you're going to look back and say, gee, we championed a cause that many years ago.
Yeah.
And these little small steps are going to make a change in the future. So it's a wonderful idea. I hope that we can be the first in or second in Canada to go ahead and do it.
That's fantastic. Thank you guys so much.
Thanks.
It takes a lot of courage to do what Emily did, and it takes a lot of courage, too, from councillors to do what they did. This is going to be a tough vote, but it is the right vote to take. And I should actually say, when I was having this correspondence with Berkeley, it was the region of Waterloo that in its climate change action plan said, we are going to consider in the future these climate change warning labels. So it's sort of on the agenda for something that they want to consider. They haven't committed to doing it, but they want to look at it. And when Berkeley heard that the region of Waterloo was looking at this, the emails from councillors were, what's Waterloo doing? What's Waterloo doing? So they actually looked to you guys for leadership, which is pretty inspiring. And that is what I think it's going to have to come down to, leadership. I've watched for my whole entire life conference after conference after conference after conference, and it seems like there's 200 countries that all want to hold hands and, okay, everybody, are we all in? 1, 2, 3, let's take a step. Oh, hang on, you're not in? Okay, let's not do this whole entire thing at all. The only way you change anything, the only reason countries all over the world have warning labels on their tobacco packages is because Canada led. And I'm going to propose to you guys that we lead. I want us to join Emily. I want us to join Emily. I want us to support the people in West Vancouver, the people in California, the people on the West Coast. I think if we do this, if we join them, if we work together, if members of the community take this forward to Waterloo, to Kitchener, to Cambridge, to Guelph, if staff is on board, and I know some of you are here, I invite you to read the 40-page legal report. I know it's a lot, but hopefully at the end of it, you'll be convinced that yes, we do indeed have the authority to pass this into law. And for any councillors or mayors or other people that are present, I would encourage you, I recognize this will be a controversial vote, but I'm going to encourage you to step up and lead, because that's the only way we're going to address climate change in a meaningful way. Thank you.
Am I?
Thank you.
I'm on. Yes, good. So just on top of that, I mean, what specifically are you looking for people to do? Just as a taking off point.
Well, we have a donate button on our website. No. Mm-hmm. So if you're a member of the community, go to our website. It's sort of 95% done, but we've got one section where it's step by step what you can do to make this happen in your community. So it involves a bit of outreach. Over here, I'd encourage you, there are some people in t-shirts that have our logo. They're part of the Our Horizon University Waterloo Club, and I'd encourage you to talk to them. So first, you have to gain a critical mass of support. So that when you do take this down to City Hall, it's not just you in the room, there's a few people behind you. And work with counselors. I know there are a few that I can put you in touch with that would be interested in doing this, that would be interested in actually putting a motion on the table. When that happens, you as a citizen, you can sign up to speak to it. You can get 4, 5, 6, 10 people of you in the room, maybe one after the other, do a short 5-minute speech. And tell your counselors, this is the greatest challenge of our time. It really is. Ban Ki-moon, the head of the United Nations, have said, this is the moral challenge of our generation, and we hear that more and more. So use your voice to sort of step up and change the world. And I think it can happen here. I think it could happen here. I don't see why it can't. So get in touch with the people with the t-shirts. That's the first step. Write to your counselors, tell your family members. You could send an email from our website as well. And I would even encourage you to read that legal opinion, because one thing that sometimes politicians do hide behind is this, is this our jurisdiction? Maybe the province can do this instead. Maybe you know, we'll say Ottawa can do this instead. It's a way of passing the buck, and you see it happen time and time again. But when they say, you know, but what about the shark fin case? If you read the legal opinion, you'll be able to counter that. In any event, just go to our website and talk with people here in the t-shirts.
Cool. So there's an epigraph in your legal opinion, actually, that I'm going to read. It's a Marshall McLuhan quote, which is, "The medium is the message because it is the medium that shapes and controls the scale and form of human association and action." Mm-hmm. So why that quote?
Shapes and controls the scale and form of human association and action. So the medium really is the message. And while it's important, this language, I think, when I was drafting this language, I think it's factually true. I think if a court looks at this, this would be upheld in court. And so the message on the nozzle is important, but at the end of the day, the medium is the message. So there are wonderful books out there on climate change, documentaries, reports that come out seemingly every day, but that medium all has the problem is out there. I'm sort of detached and separate from it, right? So how does that then inform action? What this does, if you think about it, so this can inform the scale and form of action. So the scale of action, this accesses an audience that it's hard to access. When I'm on Facebook and I'm sharing things and retweeting things, it's all in a bubble. It's not going outside of my bubble. This engages an audience that typically doesn't get engaged in these issues. So that speaks to scale, but form, this has people connected to the problem. All of a sudden, it's not this abstract thing that's out there. It's something that I participate in, that I'm in part responsible for. And I think, you know, as a corollary to being responsible for something is, well, wait a minute, I can then shape things, I can influence things. So on the action side of things, maybe people might, for the first time ever, hear from, a politician might hear from, not the typical lobbying advocacy group that they always hear from, but someone they've never heard from before. And then another call from, you know, maybe a mother or a parent of kids that has never called their counselor or MP on an issue before, might call and say, I'm frustrated at seeing this, you know, do something about it. Why don't we have better public transit? I really do think it's a game changer, precisely because the medium is the message.
Yeah, and it's there's a motivational sort of kernel in there, as opposed to it just being a point of awareness about, about what you're doing, right? And then maybe the image is upsetting.
Well, it's true, and I also think, you know, so people sometimes ask, well, what if someone doesn't believe in climate science? How is this going to convince a quote denier, right? And the objective is not to convince the deniers. For those of you, I know there's a couple of classmates that took marketing. There's this sort of inverted U-shaped curve. We all lie somewhere on this distribution, and there's the innovators and the early adopters on one side, and you've got the majority and the laggards on the other side. And I think those people, say the deniers or the laggards, if you engage the people sort of right at the top of the curve, and if you can shift the people in the middle, it's about engaging people that already believe and accept the science and bringing them, making them feel connected to the problem, making them feel a little more responsible, making, you know, taking these hidden costs and making them visible. If you can shift this critical amount of people to then create these favorable market conditions for reform, I think that's how you can then change new norms, or create new norms rather. And the deniers, they're not won over by fact and argument. They're just dragged into the future because this is now the way that we do things. So I think it's a critical piece for engaging a segment that might already believe in this, but just bringing them that much further to this place where they're then really eager for reform.
Right. So in the same vein of that idea of creating a new norm, let's talk a little bit about the sign. I can't remember what the terminology is. Restaurant.
Yes.
What's the term? What's the word?
The restaurant. Yeah. I guess you could call it a consumer information label.
Consumer. Yeah. Whatever. So it's outside of restaurants, like the green, yellow, and red sign denoting that a health standard has been met, basically, right? So I know that we were talking a little bit about that previously, but I mean that actually had an impact in terms of how restaurants are behaving in a relatively short time frame in Toronto.
Well, it did. There's an old quote by Justice Brandeis, I think, in the States, who says sunlight is the best disinfectant. And it's, so this idea of you got to shine the light on something to cause change. And so before these consumer information labels came into effect, compliance with health standards were low. All of a sudden now you've got a green, a yellow, a red sticker on the door, on the entrance to the restaurant, and restaurateurs are saying, uh-oh, well, we really can't fail our inspections because the public is going to see it. And so compliance shot up, and it's now something like 90 to 95%. So they have had an impact. But more interesting is the restaurant, I think it's the Ontario Hotel, Motel, and Restaurant Association. Actually, when the City of Toronto rolled out this program to put these health advisories on restaurant windows, the industry did not like that, and they challenged the authority of the City of Toronto to pass that into law. They lost. They then took it up to the Court of Appeal, and they lost again. So you now have this precedent at the highest court in Ontario that we're actually drawing on as a part of this that says, and the city in that instance, Well, the health inspection powers come from a provincial piece of legislation, but the city actually relied on its licensing powers and its general health and welfare powers to pass that idea into law. And that's what we're relying on here. So we're asking cities to care of their licensing powers and care of their general health and welfare powers, pass this into law. And the interesting thing is, too, going back to the tobacco warning labels, So that case, tobacco companies argued when the federal government said, we're going to pass this law that says you need to put a warning label on your package. Tobacco companies said, no, we don't like that. And you're actually violating our Section 2B, charter freedom, charter rights and freedom guarantee, freedom of expression. And the argument that they made was this packaging is sort of our real estate on which we have a right to communicate our commercial message. Or not communicate anything at all, and you, as the government, are taking that space to put your own message, so it's sort of like compelled speech. You're infringing our freedom of expression. And that went up to the Supreme Court of Canada, and they actually won. And the reason that they won, the tobacco companies, is because at the time, the warning label was unattributed. Now, if you buy a package of cigarettes, the reason it says Health Canada on it is because of that case. So the federal government subsequently amended their legislation so that it is attributed. It went up to the Supreme Court of Canada again, and it was upheld. And so if you look at our warning labels, you'll notice right at the very bottom in fine print, it says required by municipality of courage bylaw, and then a made-up number. And we're borrowing from that precedent. We're anticipating that Section 2B argument, and we're with that attribution sign. So the tobacco warning labels provide some precedent. And then the example, which was a municipal initiative, those consumer advisories, which if you think about it, you could see how this quickly becomes analogous. We're saying this retailer, this license holder, should have a label on its product that communicates the risks of the use of that product. It, you can see how it starts to become analogous to that, that sign, that consumer advisory on a restaurant's window that basically communicates health concerns associated with the consumption of their product. And there's more, I encourage you to read that 40-page report, but that's a bit of a some of the precedent that we rely on.
There's another Toronto example around the shark fin ban as well that, mm-hmm. that relates to this too, right? So the courts recently ruled that that was beyond the powers of the municipality. Is that
exactly
correct? So how does that relate to this initiative?
Well, we've had a few people ask us that question. So the shark fin ban, a few cities across Canada passed this. Toronto was one, and there was a decision, I think it was released maybe a little over a year ago, maybe even a year and a half ago, the Eng decision, where Justice Spence looked at whether or not the city had authority to pass this into law, and ruled that they didn't, ruled that it was ultra virus, so beyond their powers. And what's interesting is people say, well then, wouldn't that affect this? And so there's three key points to sort of take away from that decision. One, is right out of the gates, that was a ban on an otherwise legal product, right? So before the bylaw is passed, you can buy the stuff, sell it, eat it, do whatever you want. After the bylaw is passed, you can't. So it was a straight up ban. If you think of how that sort of infringes on one's right to do business and whatnot, that's quite substantial. This is just the provision of information. So before it's passed into law, you can consume as much gas as you like, after as much gas as you like. It's just information. So right out of the gate, they're very different, and I think that a court would consider that. But more to the point, the context for that is entirely different than the context for this. So it was in 2011 that shark fin ban sort of quickly in municipal circles became a cause célèbre. People were sort of looking at this. People, I think in the end, a handful of cities passed it into law. But there was no real historic consideration by municipal government of this issue. It was very much a live issue. Unlike climate change, where cities all across Canada, and if you go to the Federation of Canadian Municipalities, if you go to their website, have taken hundreds all across Canada, hundreds of initiatives to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. And this has been going on for over a decade. So the context is entirely different. And the sort of the last point, which is I think most salient, is in the instance of the shark fin ban, so the location of the act that caused the harm and the harm itself occurred in oceans far away. So that person finning the shark happens way far away, and the harm itself is experienced way far away. And in that case, it was this sort of, you know, loose principles of supply and demand. Well, if we buy this stuff, then that creates this need for this thing, and isn't there a relationship? So the municipal nexus was fairly weak. In this example, as soon as I finish gassing up, I turn my keys in the ignition, I'm emitting CO2. I'm contributing to this problem. When, you know, even just I was walking on the sidewalk thinking, 6 feet from my face, cars are passing me, spewing this stuff. I'm inhaling it. It's going into my lungs, you know, circulating through my blood. This is happening, not in far, far away places, but right here in cities. It is very much a local issue. So the source of the harm is local, the harm is experienced local. I think there's a strong enough municipal nexus in this instance that it would be upheld by a court of law.
And anybody is welcome to jump in at any time and ask questions. Just come down to the microphones, please, and I'll keep my eyes open for you. I mean, that's an interesting example, bringing it down to you walking on the street and experiencing mm-hmm. that. Initiated this idea for you? Where did you land on it?
Well, I think this is, a lot of people have asked this question. I think it's a result of a perspective. So I remember it was grade four. I had my teacher at the time, so acid rain. I'm looking at Josh, we were probably in school at the same time. So if you guys remember, not that long ago, acid rain was always in the news, and we had a unit, and my teacher showed me this image. It was all on one image. It was a picture of a cartoonish sort of a dead fish You knew it was dead because it had the cartoon X's on its eyes. It was floating on this water. And as a kid, you always ask why, right? So, okay, there's this dead fish. Well, why? What killed the fish? And so, oh, well, the water looks really strange. It looks green. It looks weird. There's something wrong with the water. So it's the water that killed the fish. But why? And then, you know, you see these funny drops of rain coming down into, so you're, okay, so it's the raindrops. It's something to do with the raindrops. You follow the raindrops to this murky, strange-looking cloud. Well, why is this cloud looking this way? And you then, all in this one image, there's this smoke coming into this cloud that's coming from this smokestack. And oh, it's something in the smokestack. Of course, that's attached on to a factory. And I think for most people, that's sort of the end of the analysis. And that's why the narrative, I call it the enemy narrative. It's always, it's that big bad company. And so we get mad at them and we sort of absolve ourselves from this whole thing. But in that picture, I asked, well, why? Why, right? And on the side of that factory was this conveyor belt pumping out some kind of a widget, who knows what, and at the end of that was people. So from a young age, I think I had this understanding that at the end of the day, that dead fish, we are actually all connected to that. We all share in responsibility for it. And so I think with this general understanding, with this general perspective, naturally then, well, sure, this idea makes sense, it fits. And what I've noticed, which is interesting, and I notice this strong among sort of activist circles, there is this tendency to sort of end the analysis there. And so that's, I think, why we say, you know, we go after pipelines, we go after, and I do actually think that there is a need for that. But at the end of the day, I really do think if we focus on the demand side of the equation, if we create this sense of sort of uncomfort, discomfort with the current solution, that's a way of then driving change upstream. Because as long as it's this thing that's happening out there, I'm not sure that we're going to be able to move forward on it in meaningful ways. And it's always, and if you think about even, as I said before, the idea, the first step in addressing any problem is to sort of honestly face it. If we think about challenges in our own lives, you know, when did you have the most success? When you're saying, oh, they need to change, it's their problem. Or when you took that moment to have that honest, you know, hey, I actually do play some role in this. And I think it's that place that can then engender a transition.
Yeah, I like when we were talking last time when you were down here a couple weeks ago, I the idea that resonated nicely with me was the idea that if you want to lose weight, you need to look at yourself over and over in the mirror for a long period of time before you finally go, okay, I'm going to do something different about this, right? It doesn't happen immediately or because of one thing. It's something that accumulates over time. Mm-hmm. Wait, I guess. Do you have a question? Right down at the bottom here with by the exit sign with the red circle.
This one on the right.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. I noticed that the cigarette company's picture, it's pretty brutally moving. And I was wondering, the language and the photographs for the pumps don't seem to be nearly as strong of a message as on the cigarette package. So I was wondering if you guys had to come to terms with, I don't know, what you're going to use. Like, I mean, you have animals and the claim that you may end up making them go extinct as compared to you're witnessing a picture of someone dying of lung cancer.
It's true. And so there is research that shows the more graphic the image on the tobacco package, the more compelling it is, the more impactful it is. The interesting thing is if you look at the evolution of those warning images, they actually started out a little more gentle and they progressively got a little more graphic over time. And so we made a strategic decision, whether it's the right decision or the wrong decision, I don't know. But we made a strategic decision because I think this concept alone will be challenging enough for people to put this on the gas pump. And we thought if we make it quite graphic, you know, will it actually get passed into law? Will we create too much opposition? Whereas if we start with something a little more gentle, maybe people will be less opposed to it. So there's definitely that. It's a strategic decision. It could very well be that when this is passed into law, you know, a decade later, we might have some more graphic images, who knows? So that's part of the thinking behind it. But I do think at the end of the day, so the language with the maze and whatnot, that's just science. It's just the nature of uncertainty. And people often actually, you know, they say, oh, but the IPCC, they're always saying it may, and in this sort of a thing, it's always about probability. So people sometimes dismiss the science because of that, but that's just the language that scientists use. So there's that. But also, I would remind you, I think at the end of the day, while yes, this is important, and I think you can have images and text that's more impactful and images and text that's less impactful, I think at the end of the day, what's most important is the placement of this on the gas pump nozzle, the whole medium is the message thing. So if you can just in that moment disrupt this act that has forever been normal and unquestioned and draw attention to it, that then creates space for a conversation to consider alternatives. So who knows, it could be, and the nice thing too about doing this at the municipal level is there's room to experiment. So it could be in the West Coast, I mean, something like 10 million mussels were lost to ocean acidification and 10 jobs in Nanaimo at this plant. People lost their jobs because of climate change. And so it could very well be that you might want to have that in Nanaimo. Maybe you might have something different here in Kitchener-Waterloo in another place. So, and that actually also, I think, highlights the local nature, too, of climate impacts and speaks to why a municipality is actually the best level of government to implement this. I think there's room for a variety of labels for experimentation, and maybe municipalities can learn and trade, and this was really compelling here, this less so. So I think you'll see this evolve as we go forward.
Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you. Go ahead.
Yeah, hi. So thanks for promoting this idea. I hope that municipalities try it out, and I hope it works. But I'm not totally convinced by the case that it will work. It seems there's a number of issues. It seems different enough from the situation with tobacco, where it's a new enough thing that there's still, I think, the burden of proof is to show, yes, this is going to work. So I just wanted to get you to respond to some of the issues I'm sure you've thought about. With the tobacco labels, they're telling you what will happen to you or your family. Climate change is happening to everybody, or it's mm-hmm. more diffuse. It's also not clear what a lot of people would do. So if you commute in an area where there isn't public transit, it may take many years for public transit to come there. You might not be able to get an electric car if you can't afford it, or if your commute is too long, if there aren't plugs there. Or you might have to move, right? Move closer to where you work. That's what I do. But that's a much bigger thing than, quitting smoking takes willpower. But there's also questions of, what about all the other things that should we have labels on our gas bills? If where I have power to change something isn't my car, but I want to do something about climate change, is the feedback a little confused? So I guess I want to hear from you, what are kind of the issues that you worry about? Is this really going to work, and how are you dealing with those challenging issues and proving that that this can work?
So a couple of thoughts. So the issue of smoking being sort of more of a personal health hazard, whereas this is something that we share in collectively, we're all sort of harmed by the impacts of climate change. I think from a public policy perspective, there's actually a greater argument to have these on gas pumps than there is on warning labels and tobacco packages. The reason being, because if I want to, in the comfort of my own home as an individual, smoke and harm my lungs, what business really does the state have in that? And sure, so maybe there's healthcare costs and we all have to bear me smoking and there's that drain there. But really, at the end of the day, if I'm doing this in the privacy of my own home, why can't I? And why should there be a warning label? Whereas with this, we're all harmed by this. So I think there's actually more of a reason to have the warning label on the gas pump nozzle, because we're all, at the end of the day, public policy is about protecting public at large.
For sure that there's a reason, mm-hmm. but I'm wondering, that doesn't mean it'll work.
Right? Sure. And to a couple of other things you raised, so there's that piece, because you spoke about sort of the individual nature of smoking. There's also the idea of, well, what am I supposed to do as an individual, you said, and maybe I can't take public transit because it doesn't work where I live, maybe I can't afford an electric vehicle. I think it's people sometimes say, but there aren't many alternatives to this, so what am I supposed to do? Why should we have these labels if there aren't alternatives? I say it's precisely because there are few alternatives to this that we need this, because as long as the marketplace, as long as we all as consumers are sort of complacent with the status quo, as long as we're not sort of engaged on this issue or engaged by this issue, things won't change. I think if all of a sudden, you know, 1 week I see this, another week I see this, and so on, I'm exposed to different images on a regular basis, I will get frustrated. Not everyone will, but enough people will. And oftentimes with these sorts of things, it's about tipping points. It's not about convincing everyone, but if all of a sudden a counselor begins to hear from constituents that they've never heard from before, I'm frustrated and I want to take public transit and I'm worried about climate change. I recognize I'm a part of this. Why can't we do this? I think that then gives a politician a license to actually spend money on public transit. I know the conversation in Toronto, we live in fantasy land, we really do. It's, let's have public transit, whoa, but let's not fund it. It's bizarre. But I think this can move enough people to this place where a politician then has the license to do that. And as I said again, think of business as like an ecosystem. Shifts always occur. We're kind of pumping more information into the system. And if people grow less and less satisfied with their existing mobility solutions, if I'm an entrepreneur or if I'm an existing company that provides, that meets those needs, I'm gonna say, look, there's this segment nobody's catering to. We need to cater, we need to capture that market share. I'm a profit-driven business person, you know? So that's what I'm gonna do, and I'm gonna invest research and development dollars, all those cars, all those prototypes that you always see at auto shows, but never actually get developed, never actually make it to market. We might start to see that sort of a thing happen. And just through economies of scale, and you even see this with the Tesla example. So first they had a high-end, low production vehicle. Now they've got sort of a mid-end and mid-production, mid-price vehicle. Through economies of scale, as they grow their business, their third vehicle is gonna be hopefully much more affordable to a broader segment. And it's because of economies of scale. It's cheaper than to do. And as market interest grows, as there's more and more people to sell to, more and more people that are interested in solutions, I think you will see costs go down. So you could think of this as, again, as a catalyst for change. And I think it's, again, it's precisely the reason that we need these labels, because as long as there's this disconnect, I don't know that we're going to change. And I know you had some other questions in there as well, but maybe we can chat a little bit after. Or let's reconvene a decade from now and say, hey, did these things work, yes or no? At the end of the day, nobody, even climate scientists, you know, nobody can predict the future. Who would have thought that 10 years ago, or a little over a decade ago, when Canada first created these warning labels on tobacco packages, that they would spread all over the world and have the impact that they have had? I'm sure there were people having this sort of debate at the exact same time. So I guess the only way you can know is by trying.
That's true. Go ahead over here, please.
No.
First of all, I'd just like to say that's a really amazing idea. Secondly, it's more about the location of where the sticker is being placed. Like, when I usually think about if I'm filling up the gas station, I just put the nozzle in, turn around, and get angry at the prices going up, right? So would it not be a better location to put the advert, like, in one of those plastic signs that are above the actual pump itself rather than the nozzle? Because I really ever rarely pay attention to what's on the nozzle itself. It's just going into my car.
What's interesting is there is actually some market research. So this, it's called a nozzle talker. It's basically a rubber piece, retails for about $15, that fits over this very standard gas nozzle. This was invented in 1989 by a company in the southern US, and they've proliferated. You see them all over. And so there's actually a lot of market research on this. It's hard to access. But I found from the company that came out with it, and also a company in Australia, I think called Phoenix Outdoor, they find that while this is sort of the smallest piece that they have in their whole sort of options of advertising space, it's actually the most compelling piece. The exposure is regular, it's maybe once a week, it accesses millions of people. And I reference this in that 40-page legal document, but they basically say that it's partly also the unique way that the consumer then engages with the thing. So I actually do think, and there is some market information to suggest that this is a very interesting idea. And the interesting thing about advertising too is we often as consumers, we don't really fully appreciate the impact that advertising has on us. And you might not consciously be seeing that and remembering that, but at some level, you are taking that information in. I actually think it's a really compelling place to put an ad. I think in contradistinction to that other space, which is oftentimes cluttered, so there's a lot of things competing for your attention there. But, I mean, who's to say that you can't have, maybe in addition to this, something on a gas actual the station? So, thank you. Great.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Go ahead.
Hi. Firstly, I'd like to commend you for taking on my brother.
That's your brother?
Yeah.
So awesome.
I'm proud of him, you know. Good job. I'd like to ask, do you have any stories of similar ideas like this that have experienced a lot of whiplash from the public and haven't actually succeeded? Because I imagine a lot of people would be very affronted by this sort of challenge to like some very deep set ideologies.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just wondering if you could give us any examples of that.
That is a really good question. And I think that's why, I'm trying to think of examples off the top of my head, but I think that's why this is one of these things that a politician is going to vote. Well, maybe that's me, sorry. A politician is gonna make this vote, not because it's the popular thing to do, but it's the right thing to do. So people have actually asked the question, have you done any market research on, is this something that citizens want? And I'm like, one, first of all, I can't afford to do that market research. But two, even if I did, I know the outcome. People are gonna be like, I don't want this, because we don't. We don't wanna deal with this problem. So there will certainly be some blowback, for sure. But that's kind of the cost of leadership. It's a tough place to be in, and I don't envy politicians that are gonna have to decide, well, what do I do? And if you wanna change things, sometimes it does involve taking a bit of a risk, and who knows, there might be some blowback, or it could be, and this is interesting, the case of Hudson, Quebec. So yeah, it was a controversial vote at the time, but now the community celebrates these people as leaders. They look back at their own legacy and they celebrate that. There's even a documentary where the old mayor, the city clerk at the time, this is amazing, the city clerk, she didn't even have a legal education. Fresh out of high school, she drafted this bylaw that survived all the way up the Supreme Court of Canada under threat of litigation from the pesticide industry. She says, sure, we'll go to court. So it's gonna be that kind of attitude, I think, that gets this thing passed into law. There will be some blowback, even if it's not passed into law. I think there is value to having this discussion, right? If all of a sudden, and people have said this too, if all of a sudden people are like, oh, yeah, this kind of is us, right? Maybe it can in some way, help influence the direction of a community, even if it's not passed into law. I think it'd be much more impactful, obviously, if it is passed into law. Off the top of my head, I can't think of an example like the one you asked, but hopefully the last 120 seconds were somewhat enlightening.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
I work in the automotive world. Mm. It is a very unique and demanding place with very, very strong opinions that have been formed over years and years and years of the same old crap being repeated by both the automotive world and also everyone around us. How would you hope to engage the people who are seeing this day to day, who are going, yeah, whatever? Like, what would you be doing to, beyond the advertising on the pumps, which I think is a really neat idea, but what would you be doing to take that and say, hey, what's the next step? How mm-hmm. can I do this? And also, how does this affect me in the automotive industry? Because you got all the mechanics, you got all the guys selling parts like I do, the people who make cars. And we've mm-hmm. got all of that in this region, as well as the high tech. So we've got a very odd region here because of that.
Thank you for that question, and I'm glad you asked it. So I think, again, it's part of this more shift, this more collective shift that I think can engender a greater appetite for solutions. But to your point, you know, what can people do? I think this website, so if this is passed into law, there's a resource, and maybe there's options on different things people can do. Maybe if it's specific to this community, there's information on different routes, bus routes, all sorts of different things you could take. But with respect to the automotive industry, as you know right now, it's an industry in Ontario that is actually struggling. And people, especially the younger generation, we're not buying as many cars as we used to. And a lot of the industry in the past, possibly maybe even in the future, might be propped up by subsidies. So right now, it's actually not that sustainable. What I think might be interesting is, to the extent that this is, it's a simple idea, but it's just this sort of this input of information, I think communities that do this first, they're then effectively acknowledging the reality of the time that we find ourselves in. And I think that can give them what economists call a first mover advantage. So people that accept this reality, understand it for what it is, start to develop the solutions of tomorrow, we then down the road can be net exporters, right? If we continue to sort of deny the situation and we hang on to old ways of doing things, it's going to be other people that are inventing technologies, other countries, other communities that we are then importing because we've lagged on the issue. So this can, again, this can be a catalyst to maybe even rebirth in industry. Wouldn't it be amazing if we got this early sort of market signal, we jumped on it, and we innovated, we developed solutions that down the road people look to hear and say, look what they're doing, we need to get their stuff. So I think status quo really, in economic terms for that sector, is unsustainable. This can sort of be potentially, hopefully, some impetus to innovate, to get it to a more sustainable place where we can then lead.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Keaton asked about the reaction of the public. I'm curious whether the petroleum industry has caught wind of this, whether they've activated their PR people, mm-hmm. and whether you've seen any indication of pushback from them.
Well, so this is funny. Ezra Levant, right? He invited me to his TV program. And I'm like, oh God, that's a booby trap. I'm not walking into that. So I know that we're on sort of that radar. So I declined. I declined the interview because I thought, well, that's just silly. It's a circus of a show. But a friend of mine, a guy who I met that works for an environmental organization that works a little more closely with that sector, the oil and gas sector in Calgary, he went there for a meeting with a whole lot of oil executives and doing whatever business they were conducting. And then at the end of it, he's like, have you heard of this little group called Our Horizon out of Toronto? They've got this little warning label campaign. And they said, and this was probably just a few months in, they said, yeah, we know about them and we're monitoring them. And my impression is, through that conversation with him, is this is a campaign that they're worried about because it really is different. It engages a segment of society that is never, never engaged in this issue. And as long as it's the stereotypical activists that, you know, are marching down to Queen's Park and making noise and so on. And again, I think it's going to take a variety of approaches. So I don't want to devalue that. And I've certainly been to those rallies. But I think this is something that they recognize, this is a little different. Because it does. It engages people that otherwise are never engaged in this issue. So it's something that's on their radar in terms of blowback. I mean, sure, they have deep pockets, just like tobacco had deep pockets. But in the end, you know, our legal system is such that federal government was vindicated. Courts found that they had the authority to pass this law. My estimation is I think this would be vindicated as well. I should add the caveat, obviously I'm a little biased here. So seek your own independent legal advice, consult, you know, your legal department and so on. It's a little CYA. I think they're aware of us, and I actually think this is a campaign that they're concerned about because of the potential impact it might have.
Thank you. Could I just add one quick comment?
Please.
I like the idea of going through the municipality, but there's a quick way of getting these labels on the pumps. Hand them out to college students and tell them on a Saturday to blanket the
community. It's true. I didn't hear that.
So we'll take the last two questions that are here. Kai, if you want to go ahead.
Here we go. I thought I'd jump in for a quick question, actually, follow my brother there. So I know I'm a little bit biased as well, but something that I feel like needs to be emphasized a little bit more, and I'd be curious for your comment on this, is that I think when we're in a moment of crisis or as a society, or when we're faced with stress, we often lose sight of what's possible, right? We tend to become very, very preoccupied with what we're up against, and we have a lot of trouble moving our minds, that kind of mind shift towards, well, actually, where could we go, right? And I think, I mean, for me, what's always interested me most about this concept is that by challenging where we are, it kind of suggests, well, actually, you know, really, we can be a lot more ambitious than this. So I guess my question would be, you've given a lot of examples of the inefficiency in the auto sector as a whole. How can this actually, you know, looking forward 10, 20 years, how could this begin to provide, or even 5 years, how could this begin to provide far greater options to us as consumers? That's the one thing we hear about over and over again, what can I do? Mm-hmm. Our options are really being limited right now in terms of what we can do. So how could something like this actually start to give us more options?
Well, I think for one thing, there are a lot of solutions that are already out there. There's lots of places we can begin to transition to. And that, I think, is this part of a vision, building a compelling vision of this future that we want. And that provides this pull. And people are working on those sorts of solutions. And I'm sure even here, this is a community of technology, of innovation. Solutions are available today. I think what this adds is it adds that push. As you say, it challenges the status quo, makes it sort of so that we're less satisfied with it and more interested in alternatives. So I think in conjunction with other organizations, other people that are working to build that compelling future, that are providing that pull, this can help just give us this push that we need, which a lot of this I think comes down to just status quo, inertia. This is the way we've always done things. This is, you know, this is all I know. And by forcing someone, you know, at the pump to say, well, what am I supposed to do? If not this, then what? That creates space for us to then be open to all those other solutions. So I think then this can be seen as part of a more holistic, this is part of a broader, larger package where our contribution is that push, and there are people then that are working on that pull. And on that pull, you can plug your own initiative if you want to right now. No.
Thanks.
Yeah, thank you, Kai. Actually, if I can, just for 1 second, Kai's been amazing, and yeah, please. Thanks, Kai. Thank you.
So we'll take one last question here from Matt. Go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for coming, and thanks for your presentation. It was great. So my question is about the psychological impact, your psychological argument, which is great. We were talking about this in the office today, and we were talking about some of the reasons why and you would know this better than I would, so please correct my assumption if it's incorrect, where the cigarette label warnings became so effective is because they kept growing in size. You'd see it, and then you'd sort of ignore it next time around, but then it got bigger, and then it caught your attention again. And then you ignore it, and then it got bigger again until, you know, and magnified the impact. So I have a similar question about your proposal. What's next? What's after this, you know, 2-inch by 2-inch sort of label? Is, you know, do you have a next step for that? Does it get bigger?
My one friend Jordan actually made the suggestion just the other day. His grandmother is such a nag. He nags him, Jordan, eat your food, Jordan. So he's like, you should have my grandmother at every pump, just nagging people, you know? So sorry, Jordan's grandmother, if you actually see this. She's a lovely woman. I think, so you're right. What's interesting is studies show, they call it the adaptation effect or exhaustion effect. And so recommendations on the tobacco warning labels are rotate the labels. So every maybe year or so, come out with fresh images, because otherwise people do tend to adapt to them. They become less effective. So I think a community that rolls out some images might then a year later roll out some different ones just to sort of keep it fresh. It's interesting because I guess on a tobacco package, and progressively they have occupied more and more space, at the end of the day, there is only so much to sort of work with. So they would sort of face that challenge too, where they then max out on space and where to go from there. So we, of course, you know, we're already sort of at 100% with this sort of a thing. So I don't know if there's other ways to make it bigger, what else you can do with it. Definitely to keep it fresh, one of our suggestions that we include in that report is to roll out, you know, a new series of labels every year or so. But it could be that maybe a year or two down the road, someone might say, oh, here's another thing we can do. Here's another thing. So I actually don't know right now what are some additional next steps in terms of growing this initiative. It could be that we'll learn that as time goes on. But I think what's interesting is how this piece can then facilitate, you know, other changes. So tobacco warning labels, you know, started with that. And then we had less advertising in other spaces with tobacco. Then we had, you know, it went behind the counter, and then it was sort of hidden. So that sort of public health challenge has been dealt with in creative ways. It could be that this is a beginning point. And frankly, who knows what's next? I'm not sure what's next. Maybe there's going to be some restrictions or disclaimers on advertising. Maybe if after we implement this, there might be more of an appetite for that. Maybe we'll see some sort of an evolution. I don't know what the next steps are, but maybe, you know, what do they say? It's you might not see the end of the staircase, but be brave and take that first step. So I think this is a first and important step, that if we're able to do this, who knows? Who knows where we might go from here?
Well, I'm actually going to something small on there, in the sense I was just thinking of West Vancouver as you were mentioning that, and the mm-hmm. fact that they already have, for example, electric charging stations at a lot of their gas stations. So I think what's interesting about this initiative is that it might get to the point where it moves the market so quickly in a different direction that it's planned obsolescence in a way, right? It might become obsolete and unnecessary because the markets change. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of the whole visioning of what's possible, the idea that we can move beyond this to other alternatives. Anyway, I wanted to thank Rob and Eric for giving us a tremendous and invigorating discussion tonight. And for all of you for engaging in it. I think that ultimately it's, you know, through having these kind of communal discussions that we can really start to create the solutions that work for our communities. So thank you very much. And yeah, if you'd like to join us out in the lobby for some further conversation, we also have sign up there if you're interested in hearing updates.
I've decided, so I took the bus tonight. I'm crashing at Kai's place. We're going out for drinks. People are welcome to come and join us. Is there a place nearby if you have any other questions
I'm sure we'll find a place around. But yes, we'd be very open to continuing the discussion with anybody who's interested. So the night certainly doesn't have to end here. Thank you very much, and let's give these gents a round of applause.